I got a really cool image blurring technique in NativeScript that you can do in a cross-platform way, and it's gonna really surprise you how easy it is to do. It's gonna work on iOS and Android, and we're gonna start now. Hey everybody, welcome back. This is Alex. If you're new here, please consider subscribing to the channel where you'll get NativeScript tips, tricks, and tutorials like this one. And if you like this video, give me a like down below. By the way, the videos and tutorials that you see here on this channel are like the sugar on top of the core learning material that we have on nativescripting.com, where you have full NativeScript Pro courses available. These are courses that are in-depth and advanced, and we even have some free courses for you to get started. You can check the link down below in the description and a discount code included. All right, so today we're doing a blurring technique. It's actually pretty easy to do because what we're doing is blurring an image. And as far as I know, this is the only way to do a cross-platform blur that's gonna look the same on iOS and Android. And it's a very surprisingly simple technique, but I think it's pretty useful and you can even use it in your own apps. I bet you'll find an application for it. Now, before all the comments start rolling in saying that this is a trick, well, it is a trick, and we're all about tricks here. We're about using different kinds of tips and tricks to make your apps better and more performant. Now, iOS has its own blurring of views that's a little bit different than the technique I'm about to show you, but it's hard to get that on iOS and on Android in a cross-platform way. However, the advantage of the iOS blurring technique is that it can work on any views and not just images. And we'll cover that in another video. But for today, let's check out how we can blur images. As usual, we're going to start off with the Hello World template. This is the TypeScript template, and we got our Hello World app set up. I'm going to go ahead and right away drag in a cute image of a puppy. Look at that. Very nice. Let's go ahead and right away in our main page.xml, we're going to start using that image. I'm going to turn this top layer into a grid layout, top layout into a grid layout, and we don't need a padding there. I am going to leave a button and a label, but I'm going to delete the top label there. Let's add some rows here in a grid. First row is going to be 60, second row 200. That's for the image and then the rest of the space. All right, so our button is going to go into row 0. That's fine. I'm going to do the tab handler in code behind, not data bind it. So let's go ahead to our code behind. Ooh, this needs to clean up again. And let's just export a function called on tap. This is going to get some args of type event data. And we might as well, since we're here, just go ahead and get this view, which is the button, but we're just going to keep it as a view. It's going to be args.object. I'm going to cast it as view. We'll come back to that in a second. Let's finish the rest of this here. So after the button is going to be in row 0. I want the image of that cute puppy. Remember that puppy? I'm going to put that in row 1. And let's give this image an image source. So that's coming from the root of the app, puppy.jpg. This label down here, I'm just going to say dog. That's also going to be in row 1. So I'm going to put that in row 1 there. Let's give this label an ID. We're going to grab that later. I'm going to give it an ID of label. Pretty simple. And I'm going to give this our own class of LBL. We don't really need text wrap because it's just short string there. Now I'm going to open up app.css. And over here, I'm just going to define the LBL class for our label. Since this is going to be a label on top of our image and our image is, let's just assume a darker color. You can control this label however you like. I'm just going to make it white. It doesn't really matter. Font size is going to be 40, pretty large. And let's give it font weight bold. And I want to text align it to center. And finally, I'm going to vertical align it to middle. That's our label, and we're done with app.css. And I think we're all set up. Look at this. Yeah, there we go. We got our picture of a dog. We got the text, the label of dog on top of the image. And we got a little button here that we can tap. There is a way to blur this image on iOS using the native APIs, using all sorts of crazy techniques. I might do a video on that a little bit later. But on Android, there's no really easy way of doing this. So the technique I'm about to show you applies only to images and only to static images or images that you already have in your app, images that you're deploying. So it's not true blurring in a sense of on-the-fly blurring because we're going to be cheating. I'm gonna take a look at this puppy image here, and I'm going to go ahead and pop this open in a little program called Photoshop. Now, you could use any graphic editing utility that you might have available, as long as it has blurring. Using Photoshop, I'm gonna apply a blur, and this does a whole lot of different levels of nice blurriness. I'm gonna use a Gaussian blur, and I'm just gonna do radius of 20 pixels. There we go. That looks pretty good. I'm gonna save this new image as puppy-blur.jpg, and I don't really care about quality. I just want a lower file size. And there we go. Now we have two images, the blurred image and the regular image. I'm gonna make a copy of this image right here and make sure the blurred image is displayed after the regular image here, also in row one. And here we're gonna need an ID. So I'm gonna give this an ID of image puppy blur. And you'll see why we need that in a second. Let's just quickly take a look at our app. Now, we did add a new file here, so HMR might have not picked it up. You might need to do a little restart of the application in order to see it on both iOS and Android. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that. All right, and there we go. So now we have a blurry image on top of our clear image. And I'm gonna give this blurry image an initial opacity of 0. I'm also gonna give our label an initial opacity of 0. That way we only see the clear image without the label, just like that. Now when we tap, we wanna switch that up. We want the opacity to animate, and we're gonna use the animation API. So that's coming from TNS core modules / UI / animation. And the two objects we want is the animation class and the animation definition interface. Remember how we gave our label and our blurry image IDs right here? We're gonna get a hold of these in our code behind when we tap the button. So first we're gonna get the blurry image, and we're gonna use the view and the page of the view, and then we're gonna get view by ID. This is gonna be that IMG puppy blur, and we're gonna cast it as view. They are images, but images inherit from view, so that works. And I'm just gonna copy this line to get our label, and our label has an ID of label to make it nice and simple. Now, outside of this function, I'm just gonna have a local variable that says blurry, and we're gonna set that to false initially. And when we tap the button, we wanna switch that. So I'm gonna say blurry equals not blurry. We're gonna toggle it, all right? And after that, I need to create a new animation, pass in some animation definitions in here, and then play that animation. All right, so how do we get these animation definitions? Well, I'm gonna go down here and create a function called create animation definition, or create anim def. I'm gonna take in a view that we want to animate, and then do we want it to be visible or not? All right, so that's gonna be a Boolean, and it's gonna return an animation definition. So here we're gonna create a definition. It's gonna be of type animation definition. And this has a lot of different things you can fill out on it. As you can see, all the different animation properties and the target. The target is very important because we need to know what we're animating, and that's gonna be the view itself. We need the duration. I'm gonna set that to 500. And we also need to set the opacity, because opacity is what we're animating. So if visible is passed in, then we want the opacity to be 1. Otherwise, we want the opacity to be 0. I'm going to return this definition. And when we create a new animation up here, we pass in an array of animation definitions. So we're animating two things here. One is the image and the other one is the label. I'm going to call that create animation definition function with the blurry image and the blurry flag. And then I'm gonna call that function again to create another animation definition for our label this time, also passing in the blurry flag. So when we tap the button, the blurry flag is gonna go from false to true. We're gonna create two animation definitions and then play them at the same time. One is gonna be the blurry image, and since we're passing in true for blurry, our opacity is gonna be 1, so we're gonna fade that in. And the next time we tap the button, we're gonna flip-flop that blurry flag, and then we're gonna fade each one of these views out. So let's check it out. I'm gonna pop this open, I'm gonna tap on the button, and there's our blurry image that animates over on top of our clear image, and the label animates on top of that. And if I tap again, we get the clear image back. So you can toggle this way back and forth like that. And that's something you can do on iOS anyway, using native APIs, but on Android, it's not that easy. However, using this technique on Android, it is pretty easy. So there's lots of different ways to be creative in native script and think outside the box, not only in native script, but in application development. And this is a really cool technique that's actually really simple to do, and it works cross-platform. Now, a couple weeks ago, I did another pretty interesting technique that I showed you how to do, and that's this video, Apple Store button with content view and making creative looking buttons using the tools that you already have available in native script. So again, this is going to be cross-platform, and I also show you how to use the content view element in this video. So let's check out some of the comments you left me there. Alexandru, welcome back. He says, nice vid again. You know that we have a few layouts in native script. It would be nice if you can do a video to explain the differences between them from a performance point of view. Yeah, that would be a very useful video. Actually, Shiva already has a video on YouTube. Shiva is a regular on this channel. He's had a few videos here. If you check out his channel, he has a video about layouts. It doesn't compare the performance of layouts, but it just shows you how to use the different layouts. So check that out. Sagar says, love the thumbnail. Thanks a lot, Sagar. That was inspired by a very famous meme. CyanGen85 says, nice thumbnail here. Got the reference. Great vid. Thanks. Satyam says, great video. Please do a video on native script dialogues. Native dialogues provided by the NS API have so many limitations, like we can't even apply basic font style, etc. Well, as of native script 6.3, you have a little bit more control. And actually, I got a video on that coming out very soon, and the new controls you have available to use and customize the native modal dialogues that come with native script. So be sure to subscribe so you don't miss that video. And Denser Technologies, Denser or Denser? I'm pronouncing it Denser, but it may be Denser. Denser Technologies says, Alex, please make a tutorial on how to make full screen video player. The present plugin does not offer it. Well, I know that it's possible to make a full screen video player because, let's see, the Suite app actually does this. If you go to the app stores and check out the Suite app that was built by NStudio, a very nice looking native script app that's in the app stores right now. And that has a full screen video player with a video playing in the background. And that would make a very nice tutorial. I'll consider that and I'll put it on my list. Thanks, Denzer. All right, be sure to subscribe. You can tweet at me. I'm @DigitAlex on Twitter. And I'll see you in the next one. Happy native scripting.